You've been saying we need this, we need this, we need this, and it was almost dead. Is it coming back?
We have a shot at it. White House still has to demonstrate not only that they have the desire to bring a bill back, but that they have the wherewithal to make the bill stick, because Mitch McConnell has significant opposition on his side. That's why he's not been able to do anything. Nancy Pelosi and Chuck Schumer are going to put together a scaled-down bill that comes pretty close, actually, to what the White House has been talking about, and they'll get a chance to walk the walk and not just talk the talk.
One of the key elements of that is unemployment, supplemental unemployment insurance, and you've pointed out to me that we're coming up against a deadline on that.
Yeah, we sure are. There's another 1.5 million claims this week, and we're about to hit a grim milestone. Most states provide 26 weeks of regular benefits, and that means last week was the first week many workers had exhausted their regular state unemployment. However, the data on continuing claims for regular state unemployment is delayed a week, so we won't see that until next week. But here is the good news, David. The good news is that after an individual exhausts regular state benefits, they can move to pandemic emergency unemployment compensation, and that could give them an additional 13 weeks of regular state unemployment, but that's only available to people who were on the regular state UI and not those that were on pandemic relief to begin with.
Richard, as we know, you represent over 12.5 million workers across the country. Do you have any visibility into what's coming around the corner when it comes to unemployment? We wait every month and look at those jobs numbers, but it's backward-looking. It's not forward-looking.
Well, you still have 11.5 million less jobs than we did in February, and we're about to hit another milestone. On the end of September, the relief that airlines were getting to keep people on the payroll is going to expire. United has already said they'll lay off around 50,000, American 25,000. And here's the tragedy of that, David. These are all licensed people. And once they lose their job and their licensing sometimes goes with it, they have to get relicensed, or they go somewhere else and they won't come back, and the airlines will be stuck without licensed people. It's a sin that we're about to let that happen. Hopefully, the new bill that Pelosi and Schumer are crafting will have that aid for airlines and transportation in it, and we'll see what the White House does with it.
Richard, another thing we've talked about quite a few times is you're pressing OSHA, the Occupational Safety and Health Administration, for a temporary emergency standard having to do with pandemic. Are you making any progress?
You know, we're really not. And I've told you that OSHA has been just AWOL in all this process. I need to give you two examples of that, how weak and feeble their response has been. Throughout the entire pandemic, until September 10th, OSHA had only issued four violations for coronavirus stuff, four. On September 10th, they issued Smithfield Foods a fine. Smithfield Foods got fined for infecting 1,300 workers and killing four of them. And the fine was $13,494. The very next day, on September 11th, Swift Beef Plant, a $52 billion meatpacking company, was fined. OSHA found that the operator failed to maintain a safe working environment and that they were fined for unsafe conditions that led to the death of eight workers. They were fined $1,951.87 per death.
Wow.
I mean, that's not even enough for Swift to even notice. That's not even a rounding error. And that's what they were fined for, killing eight workers.
Boy.
And you wonder why workers continue to die and get infected in this pandemic. OSHA has simply been away from the job, and when they do find something, it's the slightest slap on the wrist and it has no deterrent effect whatsoever, Dave.
It's a very powerful point, Richard. Let's look forward to the election right now. And I want to know, from your point of view, what kind of support can the former Vice President Biden expect out of organized labor? Because there was a piece in Politico that was brought to my attention that suggested while at the national level, a lot of the national unions are supporting former Vice President Biden, at the local level, a lot of union members are diehard supporters for President Trump. What are you seeing at the AFL-CIO?
There are some supporters at the local level, but it's a small percentage. He got 3% more of our members than Romney did in the last election. I don't think it'll be any different this election. President Biden has significant support, and Biden has said that he will be the best union president that we've ever had. He knows us. He knows how important a job is. He knows that it's more than just a paycheck. It's about dignity and about protecting you on the job. He'll solve the pandemic, he'll help us get manufacturing jobs back, and we'll grow. Our members know that, and every single day, he gets more and more and more support.
Well, I was going to ask, is he going to get more support from organized labor than Hillary Rodham Clinton did? Because she did not do as well as President Obama did, as I recall.
No, she didn't. She actually got 10 points less than President Obama did among our members. He will do equal or better than what President Obama did with our members. Joe Biden's known to our members. They like him. And even those members that were not really sure about it in the last election are sure about it now. Because President Trump said he's going to change the rules. And that's what they want. The rules need to be changed. Unfortunately, the way he changed the rules hurt them and hurt unions. It hurt our health and safety. It hurt overtime. It hurt a number of things. And our members understand that. And that's why they're going to come out, they're going to vote, and they're going to support Joe Biden in high, high numbers.